So, why is this this topic so of so much interest for us now? If you look at modern AI, exemplified by deep learning, then this excels already on tasks with many examples. But brains are still unbeaten on many natural tasks. For example, learning from few examples or the eye-hand coordination that we are doing so seamlessly, but robotics is still struggling with. So understanding the function of the brain is still necessary to make advances here. But there's also another perspective on this. These modern AI algorithms are optimized for the present day computers that we have with their massive floating point computing power on dense matrices. But we are paying a terrible price for this. Our brain uses about 20 watts, while the supercomputer uses 2 megawatts. And it's clear that we cannot increase the efficiency here very much, because we are coming to the end of Moore's law, where so nicely the number of transistors on a square millimeter of chip surface has doubled every few years in the past. So it's clear that we need completely novel design principles for our computers in the future, and the brain is a great example. So the question is there any hope in that we can achieve this? And this hope is expressed here on the right side. On the top right, you see a photograph of a nerve cell, and you see the scale bar here. So the cell body has about a diameter of 20 microns. And on the lower right, you see a photograph of a modern transistor, but here the length scale is 20 nanometers, meaning that we already have a technology that can produce structures that is 3 orders of magnitude smaller than the relevant structures in the brain. So why do we have a problem then? The problem is expressed here in this photograph on the right. Here you see again a view into the tissue of the brain. The length scale is again the same, 20 microns, but this time only the outgoing structures of neurons are colored in black. The light spots are not neurons, but blood vessels. And you see that the tissue is completely densely packed with cables. There are about 100,000 neurons per cubic millimeter. Each has 10,000 contacts. But in addition, there are 3 kilometers of outgoing cables just in this cubic millimeter. And there's no technology today that can achieve this density of coupling. So this is our problem, representing the natural density of connectivity. But keep in mind that we have 3 orders of magnitude to play with. So why is the cortical network a good point to study? This is because we see universality here that gives us hope that we can uncover universal computing principles. Here you see cross sections through brains of mammals, and what is striking is that the structure of the cortex has been conserved in evolution from mouse to man. There is a 1,000-fold increase in volume, but still the local structure of the network is more or less the same. And this is not only conserved over evolution, but also over sensory modalities. Here on the right side, you see in the 3 rows photos of the cortical structure from the top of the brain down, from frontal areas, parietal areas, and occipital areas. So independent of whether the brain is processing sensory audio information or visual information, the structure that is doing this looks more or less the same. So this gives us hope for universality, and therefore this cortical microcircuit has been a field of study for long. Here you see a list of models that have been designed in the past with ever more completeness and realism. We have also contributed one here, and this is the one I will talk about in the next few minutes. But before I'm doing this, let me very briefly explain the level on which we are describing these neuronal networks. We are doing this very simplistically with a type of neuron model that is called the integrate and fire model. This is depicted here in the left upper plot. The triangles are two neurons that are connected. And like an electrophysiologist, you can stick an electrode into the inside of the first cell. This is indicated by the black bar, and record a voltage between the inside and the outside of the cell as a function of time. This is shown in the upper graph here. And if you inject a current now, then the membrane potential increases. And if it hits a threshold, then a sharp pulse is emitted that is called an action potential, and the membrane potential is reset. If the current persists, the voltage can increase again. And it's only this sharp voltage pulse that is called a spike that is transmitted to the postsynaptic cell with a short delay. And in the postsynaptic cell increases a small voltage excursion that is shown in the plot below. And what you see here is a so-called excitatory coupling. The membrane potential is driven into the direction of the threshold of the postsynaptic cell. About 80% of the synapses in the brain are of this type. 20% are inhibitory. They work the opposite way. They drive the membrane potential away from threshold. Now, the figures that you see here on the left is really very much what an electrophysiologist would see if this experiment is done on a piece of brain that is detached from the rest of the brain and kept alive in a dish. If, however, you would do this experiment in the intact brain, then you would see something vastly different. And this is shown on the upper right here. You would see that the membrane potential undergoes strong fluctuations that are basically filling all the space between the resting level and the threshold. And you would see the emission of action potentials at apparently random times. One example is shown here. But what we now know is that these fluctuations are not noise. The neurons are behaving very much like deterministic machines, as the left side indicates, but that these fluctuations come from the continuously incoming spikes from the 10,000 other neurons from which this particular neuron receives input. So on the basis of this neuron model and anatomical information from more than 50 experimental papers, we have some time ago designed a model of the cortical microcircuit that contains all the 100,000 neurons and all the 10 to the power of 9 synapses. And if you do a simulation of such a model, then you get activity like here shown on the right side, where only the spikes are marked as dots, blue for excitatory neurons, red for inhibitory neurons. And from top to bottom, we are looking from the top of the brain down into the cortex. On the to the right is time, and we see that this activity is quite realistic. We show irregular and sparse activity that is depending on the cortical layer, and also consistently the inhibitory neurons have a much higher spike rate than the excitatory ones. This model we have made available as open source. And the consequence of this was what we hoped for, that other studies used this model as a building block to do more interesting functional studies or test their theoretical works. Here on the upper right side, you see a study by our friends in Sao Paulo who could verify these results. And although this seems like a success story, this model can also be heavily criticized in the sense that it lacks all the slow frequencies that you are measuring in real recordings. Although the model is representing all the local synapses, a single neuron receives only half of its synapses locally, and 50% are coming from far away sources. And of course, we have to neglect all of them because they cannot describe them in the model. So and to overcome both of these shortcomings, we have to increase model size. In this picture here, you see that the cortex consists of at least three levels. We have the microcircuit. If we zoom out, then we see that on the level of cortical areas, there is a spatial organization. And if we move even more out, we see that the cortex falls apart in the human into 100 areas, but that each area is only connected to 10 of them. So even on the highest level, you have again an interesting recurrent network. So that we have to speak of a network of networks with at least three levels of organization. And of course, there's also another reason to reach out to these brain scale models. And this is that many of our experimental colleagues are measuring activity on the brain scale. Most prominent is probably fMRI, the resting state dynamics, for example. So if we want to make contact to our experimental colleagues, we have to be able to say something about these quantities. Now, going to the brain scale, of course, requires a whole new level of simulation technology. We are developing this in the NEST initiative. This is a public society that also carries out teaching and training. For example, at the Great Lascon School in Brazil. And why is this possible? Why can you devise a simulation technology like this? And this is because computational neuroscience has developed a separation between a concrete model and a generic simulation engine. And this allows us to represent and simulate many different models, as are depicted here on the left side, with a single generic simulation engine. In this way, a simulation engine can become an infrastructure for our work. By the way, there are also some models that can be simulated on several different simulation engines, as indicated here on the right, and as is the case for our microcircuit model. This is also useful because it enables cross-validation at the highest possible level. This facts that I just reported on the last two slides have recently been discussed by a conceptual paper, The Scientific Case for Brain Simulations in Neuron, with many different authors from the field. Now, simulating these brain scale models requires supercomputers, as shown here, the systems in Jülich and the K computer system in Japan. And there has been a decade of work to develop this simulation technology. You see the different steps here. I don't want to say much about this, but this led in 2013 to the situation that we could fill up the greatest supercomputers at the time with a neuronal network and could show that this would be K capable of simulating networks of the size of 10 to the power of 9 neurons. And so, but what also became clear is that this technology has no future, because as you see here on the right side on this panel that is labeled 4G, if you increase the number of processes, then memory usage would just explode. But another breakthrough was made in 2018, where we could show that we could devise a technology where the memory consumption of an individual compute node is completely independent of the total network size, so that also future computers could be used for large-scale network simulations. And as a side effect, this also had the advantage that a large simulation that would take half an hour with the previous technology now would run in only 5 minutes. So this seems like a big success, but it also shows our limitations, because this was a simulation of just 1 second of biological time. And that makes clear that any study of plasticity and learning is completely impossible with this hard and software. It would just take way too long. And therefore, we are also interested in neuromorphic computing. So the development of computers that work much more like the brain. Here you see two systems from Europe, the Spinnaker system in Manchester on the right. And in collaboration with our friends in Manchester, we managed to port the microcircuit model to this system. Worked perfectly after some time, as you see as a proof on the upper left. And it was a breakthrough in the sense that this is the largest network that has been executed on Spinnaker. And it is clear that all larger networks are necessarily less dense and therefore easier to simulate. However, the simulation on this system was still slower than on our high-performance computing hardware. And also the energy consumption was just at the same level as on a regular computer. And all in all, we were only using less than 1% of the Spinnaker system. But importantly, this study sparked a kind of race of different groups who would now take this building block microcircuit model and see how they could do more efficient simulations on different types of hardware. And the most recent publication you see here from the group in Manchester shows that after doing some improvements, they can execute the microcircuit model in real time. And that's, of course, an important progress. Now, with these technical advances, we are now building larger models, and we are concentrating here on the macaque visual cortex, a model of 32 areas that would in total comprise about 10 to the power of 9 neurons. I told you that this is just what we can do today. But in order to make practical steps, we are looking at a downscaled version where each area is only represented by one of our microcircuits. We have to adopt these microcircuits, because when we go up the cortical hierarchy, the neuron density decreases while the synaptic density stays the same. So the neurons are receiving more input, and this has to be respected. And of course, we also need to know how these areas are wired up. But thankfully, there are databases available, the COCOMAC database that you may know, and newer data from the lab of Henry Kennedy that allow us to compile a joint matrix telling us the number of synapses between the different areas. And here you see a sanity check of this model without doing any simulation. We just did a graph partition on the resulting network. And this shows that the clusters that come out represent the ventral stream and the dorsal stream that we know from the experimentalists to exist. So the network we are constructing is not completely crazy. Doing simulations, we see spiking activity that has more structure than in the isolated microcircuit model. And importantly, as you see in the traces below that are summing up the activity of whole areas, you see now slow fluctuations that were missing from the isolated model. They are coming through, generated by a metastable state of activity. And these slow fluctuations now give us a power spectrum of the activity that fits very well with the experimental data. Now, this shows the cover page of the publication on this finding. But after doing this, we found that maybe this publication is not really useful because our model is so complex that nobody would be able to uncover the model from this publication. One step is, of course, to make the model code open. We always do this now, but still, originally, the model code looked like shown here on the upper left, very, very hard to understand. And so we also worked on improving our simulation engine so that these models can be expressed in a more expressive and more natural type. And in order to make this transition possible, we also created a transition guide that that if you know the older version of NEST 2 tells you how to change your syntax to this more compact and flexible one. But still, we thought this is probably not enough, and we thought that here we can learn from a software development. There are, you may know, software development platforms like GitHub now that allow you to collaborate on a single piece of software or model in this case, do formal code reviews and revisions. So we put our model up into such a GitHub repository that also allows us to add the proper documentation. But then we realized that maybe it is not the final model that is the most important part of our work, but the workflow of how we arrived from the original experimental data to the final model description. And this is something that other fields have already realized, for example, systems biology, and they developed a tool that is called SnakeMake that allows you to express such workflows in a digital manner. And this we did for our model and also included this into the repository. And finally, we produced a video that explains how to use this repository to work with the model and create your own one on the basis of this. Now, this is, of course, as you could see, something for the expert. But how do we get students into this and bring this advanced simulation technology to the classroom, where we can not assume that everybody is an advanced programmer? And this, for this reason, we developed NEST Desktop. An important point in these times is that this is installation free if you want. You only need a browser to access NEST Desktop. And by this is also a contribution to distance learning, to e-learning, and to equal opportunities, because independent of what computer power you have locally or how good your university is, once you have a browser, you have access to all these advanced technologies. And still, there is a use for the more advanced researcher, and this is that with this tool, you can do rapid prototyping of network models, and also very interactively study neuronal activity. And now you may ask, where does the simulation then actually run? One example is the eBrains platform that is developed by the European Union right now. This will have Nest Desktop installed, and from this you can access supercomputer resources.
My question will be very short. Maybe I misunderstood, but it seems to me that your brain model has no sensory entry. For example, you have shown several times a model of for the macaque cortex, but I haven't seen neither retina nor LGN. How do you manage this sensory entry? Thank you.
Yes, yes, this is completely right. This is one of the major shortcomings of this model, that we don't have these further brain structures. So all the synapses that are coming into our model and where we cannot explain their origin are just replaced by Poisson sources. And this is why we only can make statements about the resting state. Yeah. And this is the limitation. And this is, it also relates to a more fundamental problem that for us, it was a lot of work to construct this model and to integrate all these data. So I think that constructing more complete models of the brain goes beyond what an individual lab can do.
Yeah.
And this was a major motivation why we put out this model as open source, in the hope that also other groups can do something more useful with it. For example, attach a retina or something.
Exactly. Yes, that makes sense. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Let me ask you a question, Marcus. I have been here every time you visit us, and in our meetings, I ask the same question, and I always like your answer. And in particular, I like it very much as the way you concluded your interview with Hawking. So you said that you believe young neuroscientists should do two things. One is to learn more mathematics, but careful not to be involved by the beauty of mathematics and forget about neurobiology.
Mm-hmm.
And the other, they should discuss with experimental biologists, neurobiologists, and hear what they have to say, but maybe not to pay that much attention, because they represent the past. So I enjoyed very much.
I
ask you again. So in this impressive simulation project, what is the place mathematics can have? And in particular, for to be more precise, so as you know, the team, Evalo Sherbar, and many people, including myself, who have been working in a simple mathematical model, which is a chain, a system with internal chains with mem of variable length. It's a stochastic model, which is simple enough to be addressed by mathematicians with available tools, but challenge enough to be interesting from the mathematical point of view. And and also he has lots of interesting features. For instance, it presents stability. It has phase transition. So the question is, a model like this has a place in the simulation project you have been developing?
Yes, it's a very important question. And the answer is the following. So if we would only do these simulations, then we get out spike data. But the data that we get from the model are almost as complex as the data that we get from the experimentalists. So without doing any theory, you don't get much understanding. So the role of mathematics here is to find simplified and understandable descriptions of what is really going on in this model. And in fact, I skipped one part of the story to make it shorter, but there's already an earlier point where mathematics comes in. And this is, if you put in all the anatomical data and you switch on your simulation, the first thing that you get is garbage. Yeah, because all the experimental parameters only have are known with a certain accuracy, and they are coming from different animals, different experiments. So in a way, you are building an average brain, and this average brain is of course not working. So you need to do stability analysis and some kind of more abstract theory to guide the detailed model into the right parameter regime and understand where the phase transitions are, as you mentioned, and the critical points. So this is the direct role of mathematical theory that I see in this, to create understanding ultimately.
Let me complement my question. So as you know, Patrice and myself and many people are also work with theoretical statistical questions. Mm-hmm. We intended to answer problems like what is the graph of interactions mm-hmm. between components of the brain. So something which I never saw any statistical analysis of all the simulation. Most of the time, what you see is, so maybe I'm not being fair. So in this case, forgive and criticize me. But what I have seen all the time is claims like, you see, this simulation looks very much what we observe with experimental data. And this is very much something which remind me when physicists in the 80s or 90s starting looking at turbulence using dynamical models.
Mm.
No statistics at all. So they say, well, look, this dynamical system behaves in a way which reminds. So how do you think we can introduce some statistical considerations as a way to see if the simulations really reproduce things which are closer to experimental data?
Mm. Yeah, so first of all, I think I completely agree that there's too little analysis done on the results of these complex simulations. How you can do this in practice, I don't know. I'm not such an expert. So what I know is that doing mean field theory helps to a certain degree. But if you do this in a too simplistic sense, then of course you are throwing away all the heterogeneity, and then you don't get this the variability back that you see in the simulation and you see in nature. So maybe that's the point where the stochastic models would come in.
About the statistical part, I know that people in Blue Brain, they are somehow trying to simulate those in much more details, in fact, the whole anatomy of, say, a cortical barrel or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And then they are trying with statistical methods to recompute somehow the connectivity to find out like highways that would go through the cortical barrel. Because, of course, the functional connectivity that you get out of a simulation is so intricate that you want to find out some statistical indicators that are much more simple than the whole raster plot, right?
Oh yeah. So that's functional connectivity.
Mm. Yeah, and I was wondering, so with your, if you tried those reconstruction of functional connectivity on your simulation to see if it's somehow what you guessed before running the simulation or if it was something surprising.
We have some data on this. Which are in the paper, but I have not shown in this talk. And this goes the following: if you compute the something like functional connectivity between the spiking activity in the different areas, for example, by using a simple measure like the cross correlation, then you get a matrix. So the matrix of functional connectivity, as you would call it, and you compare this with a functional connectivity measured in the macaque monkey in the same areas in the resting state, then you see a certain similarity between these two matrices. And this similarity has two features. First of all, it is better as if you would just take the anatomical metrics that we put into the simulation and compare this with the monkey data. So the dynamics that is going on in this network is really adding something to the explanatory power. Yeah, so that's a good point that goes maybe in your direction. And a negative point is that, of course, the match is not perfect. It shows some discrepancy, but this discrepancy is not bigger than the discrepancy between the functional connectivities measured in the six monkeys that are contributing to this data. So meaning, if we want to make progress, we may have to come ultimately to individual specific models. Yeah, because this has so much influence apparently on the functional connectivity.
Okay, very interesting. Thank you.
I didn't get exactly, so I saw it was Brunel's model that you showed, but how do you deal to implement different kinds of models? So I don't know, you want, for example, to implement a Markov chain model or some, so because there are so many families of models, and as Antonio said, this notion of mathematical models is very, there are very different models, and how do you deal with this different abstraction level, I will say computational level of these models you can implement?
Yeah, it's a very good point. So the Nest simulation engine is basically restricted to neurons that are interacting by point events, by spikes, and these spikes can have a delay. This is the level of description that the simulation engine was designed for. Over the years, it has been expanded, so now it can also include gap junctions. This is the electrical coupling between neurons, and also you can represent neuron models that are not interacting by spikes but by a continuous rate functions. This is also often used in theory, as you may know, as a further level of abstraction, where you have one unit that is representing a whole population of neurons. But basically, the way we see this from the point of view of the Human Brain Project is that we have different simulation engines on four different levels of description. For example, we are using the neuron code that has been developed by Michael Heinz and then further developed at EPFL for the level of very detailed multi-compartment neuron models and so on, because these different levels of descriptions require different optimizations of the solvers and the way that the communication is done. So as a modeler, you first have to look at what kind of model do I want and then choose the appropriate simulation engine for this.
Okay, so thank you very much. Last, just to be sure, so it's a discrete event based modeling and simulation you are using basically. I mean, the spikes, you mean points, is it discrete events and discrete event systems?
Yes. Discrete events in time that are delayed.
Okay. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.